ready. Well, good evening. Good evening. Welcome back tonight to Tuesday night. It's good to have you here tonight, and good to have Dr. McMurtry back with us and in our presentation. It's been good. Amen. And so tonight we're looking forward. I believe he's going to be talking a little bit about the origin of man tonight, if I understand that. And so we're going to let you, give you evidence tonight to prove to you you're not a monkey. Amen. Wives, if you're in question about that, maybe with your husbands, we're going to prove tonight from the Bible that that God created us separate and apart. Amen. Aren't you glad that he did? The Lord didn't die for the monkeys. He died for you, and he died for me. Amen. Well, let's stand and worship the Lord. We're going to sing one song tonight. Brother Tommy's going to come and lead us, and let's worship the Lord.
To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he had done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father, Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he had done.
Amen. You may be seated tonight as we get ready to go to prayer, and then we'll have the offering. We'll turn it over to Dr. McMurtry tonight. Does anybody have any prayer requests you want to mention tonight? Anybody? Russ? Okay, let's remember Sandy. Sarah? All right, let's pray for Brother Charles tonight. All right, continue to remember the Watson family. Amen. Anybody else? Bonnie, let's keep Bonnie in our prayers. Debbie? Butch Caldwell, okay. Homer? Michael? Okay, let's remember Michael. Amen. All right. Maggie? Yeah, Coach Booth's sister died, so let's remember the Booth family, okay. Sue?
Burt Collins.
Amen. All right, well, let's look to the Lord in prayer tonight and ask God to help us and meet with us and speak to us tonight. Heavenly Father, Lord, we love you tonight, and Lord, we come in the name above every name, the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We love you, Lord, tonight, and we praise you, Lord, for all the great things you've done. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for your handiwork in creation and all the marvelous things that we've learned about this week and the evidence, Father, that just backs up the Bible. And so, Lord, the Bible's the Word of God, regardless of anything, but we're thankful, Lord, that God allows us to see and gives us assurance in His Word, not only through just the pages of His Word, but through creation itself. But, Lord, we thankful most of all for redemption and salvation, Lord, that we have in Christ, and not only that He made man, but He made man in the image and likeness of God, to have a special relationship with Him, a relationship He doesn't have with the animal kingdom or any other part of His creation, and He died alone for mankind. So, Lord, we're thankful that You love us enough to come to this earth and become flesh and live among us and die as us and pay the debt that we could not pay for ourselves. So, Lord, that's what we're celebrating. That's what we're worshiping in You, our Savior and Redeemer. So, Lord, we pray for these requests tonight. Be with Sandy Furches tonight. God, help her and she continues to battle cancer. Lord, we pray for our lost people. Lord, we have many lost people, Father, so we lift them up to You again. Father, help us, Lord, as we'll try to go out on visitation Thursday night, and Lord, that we can knock on doors and find some lost person, or these that we've handed tracts to this week and spoken a word about the Lord to them. We pray that You'll tender their heart. Lord, we pray that they might read the Word of God and speak to their lives and hearts, Lord. And we pray for Charles Watson tonight, Lord, not feeling well. Be with Brother Charles, help him. Be with Bonnie Chambers, Lord, tonight. God, continue to help Bonnie to recover. Pray for Lord Joseph and Stephanie. God, we continue to lift them up to You tonight. And Lord, we pray for Butch Caldwell. Lord, in the hospital still, we pray for Butch and his situation. We pray for Michael Cruz tonight. God, be with Michael, Lord. We just pray that You'll begin to work in his life and meet his spiritual needs, Father. Just bring him, Lord, to You, oh God, tonight. Lord, we pray for Brother Jeff and his family, Lord, the Booth family, Lord. It's lost a loved one. So we pray that, God, You'll give comfort in the time of bereavement. Help them now. And Lord, we pray for Burt Collins tonight, Lord, and the needs there. So, Lord, we have many needs. We're a needy people, and that's why we're calling upon You. And, Lord, we believe that You're the God that can do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. So, Lord, bless Dr. McGrady tonight as he presents the Word of God and truth to us tonight. And we just pray that, Lord, You'll speak to our hearts. And, Lord, I pray through all of this, these services this week, that our faith has been encouraged and strengthened, Lord. It's given us another tool to be able to, Lord, to witness and be able to defend the faith, as Jude says, earnestly contend for the faith that was once delivered to the saints. So, God, help us to do that tonight. And we love You tonight because You first loved us. In Jesus' name, amen. Men, if you'll come for the offering tonight, before we turn over to Dr. McMurtry, what you give this week will go for the expense of the revival. So we pray that God speaks to your hearts, you give tonight. Brother Jerry, will you pray for us tonight, man? You're glad He leads us along the way. By His hand, He lead us. Well, I believe at this point we don't need much of an introduction for Dr. McMurtry tonight, and so I'm going to let him come and take over and share what God's put on his heart for the night. You come, brother.
You know, somebody who's not worth introducing is not worth listening to.
Oh, okay.
Go ahead.
Introduce yourself.
Good evening. Good evening. I'll tell you what. It's all because you guys don't have close fellowship. You know, there's one here, one there, one there.
Social distancing.
This isn't social distancing. It's barely physical distancing. Well, tonight we're going to be talking about what is really a very important subject. Again, remember, we're talking about the intellectual revival this week, and you have to have good answers to good questions. And evolutionists, people in the secular world, they're going to say, what about all that proof for human evolution? Evolutionists, of course, saying that people evolved from apes. We're going to be taking a look at that. But to set a proper perspective, you know, last night it's a little hard to pick a scripture on the age of the earth scientifically. The age of the earth is well accepted in the Bible and proved to be 6,000 years old, but you use things like the genealogies of Mary, for instance, to do that. But tonight I'd like to read a couple of verses to you when we're talking about the impossibility of human evolution. If you turn your Bibles in Genesis chapter 1, I'm going to start at verse 26. Genesis 1, 26, and God said, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Please notice the plurals there, referring to Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, correct? And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image, and the image of God created he them. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and the narrative continues from there. So the Bible clearly says that we're made in the image of God, and including Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But I'd also like to take you to Genesis chapter 9. This is after the flood, and I want to point out to you that God not only made us in his image, but killing a human being, murder, is a personal affront to God. If you take a look at Genesis 9, verse 6, whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed, for in the image of God made he man. God transfers the capital punishment. Before the flood, he dealt with people individually himself. After the flood, he transfers that to human government. But again, to kill a human being is an affront against God. And when I say kill, I'm talking about murder. Now, with that in mind, clearly the Bible tells us that God has made us in his image. But in the secular world, they deny that, correct? And because they're looking for a random chance way in which we could come into existence, they talk about how people evolved from something. So what do? They pick something that looks a bit like us. And so they talk about apes, correct? Yeah. Now, I want you to know that Charles Darwin did not say that people evolved from apes. Charles Darwin actually said we evolved from monkeys. Now, of course, evolutionists today don't like that particular terminology, so they say, oh, no, he wrote monkeys, but he meant apes. Hello? You got me? Yeah. So I want to also point out that tonight lots of things are going to happen on the screen, and often when you're least expecting them. Hello? What we're going to talk about tonight, a presentation called, quote, The Road to Man, unquote. Now, why is it termed, quote, The Road to Man, unquote? This is the terminology that evolutionists have used for decades, describing how they say that apes evolved into people. Now, you'll also notice that there are three question marks behind that. Is that correct? And so, actually, tonight's presentation is, quote, The Road to Man, unquote. Really? Hello? Yeah, it's really, quote, The Road to Man, really? So, let's take a little look at something. Do these images look familiar to you? Those look familiar? They should. They have been using these images to deceive people into believing that we evolved from apes, and they've been using this image since 1960. This is an iconic series of images. And they have been using them now for 60 years to deceive people that they evolved from apes. Now, please look at this carefully. When you see this presentation, you have to admit that when you see it, well, it does appear to have a certain logic, does appear to have a certain rationale, correct? Has a certain plausibility when you see it. But would you agree with me that simply because something might appear to be logical or might appear to be reasonable, that does not necessarily make it true, correct? Right? You see, what you're looking at is referred to as magic. Now, this is not black magic. This is stage magic. This is illusion. And we're going to show you how to debunk the whole thing. But I have another question before I do that. When you see this, again, it has a certain logic, a certain plausibility when you see it. But please tell me, when they show you this, why don't they show you that? Come on, the little fish walking out of the water? I quote Ecclesiastes, there's nothing new under the sun, correct? Evolutionists have been teaching this for over 2,600 years. 600 years before Christ was born, there were Greek and Roman evolutionists who said that fish walked out of the water and became people. You see, when you see this, it might look logical, it might look plausible, but what comes before it? Well, here it's the little fish walking out of the water. Hello? Now, if they showed you this, would you have a tendency to believe it? No. So when they show you that, it might seem logical or plausible. When they show you that, you go, wait a minute. Is that right?
Right.
Ah. Now, when evolutionists attempt to prove that people evolved from, and we'll say apes, being kind, they have four categories of physical evidence. The four categories of physical evidence are shown here on the screen. First of all, here, the drawing of the skull fragments of Piltdown Man. This is called the proof by hoaxes. The proof by hoaxes. The second category of proof, shown by the illustration of the tooth of the Nebraska Man, this is called the proof by misrepresentations. Misrepresentations. The third category of proof, shown here by the skull of this Australopithecus, this is called the proof by the bones of dead apes. Now tonight I'm going to use some big scientific words. I don't want you to be concerned about it whatsoever. I told you before, I love taking big scientific words and making two bits out of them, right? So don't be offended with Australopithecus. I'll explain that in just a moment. And finally, the fourth category of proof, shown here by the skull drawing here of a Neanderthal, this is the proof category, the proof by the bones of dead people. Neanderthals have always been classified as people since they were first found in the 1850s. And so we have hoaxes, misrepresentations, the bones of dead apes, the bones of dead people. And those are the four proof categories they use to deceive people into believing in evolution. Now, I mentioned that don't be concerned about some of these big words. Let's just break them down and see what they mean. Would that be okay with you? Yeah, I love doing this. This big old long word here, Australopithecus. Well, what does that actually mean? Well, the word austral just means southern. Australia is southern land. The aurora australis are the southern lights. And so austral just means southern. And pithecus is just the ancient word for ape. And so this big old word, Australopithecus, just means dead southern ape. See how simple this is. Now, how did it get that name? Well, it's really quite simple. When we found them, they were dead. And they were first found in Africa, the bones, but named by Europeans. Now, Africa is south of Europe, right? So they were the bones of dead southern apes. You see how simple this really is, right? And by the way, I'd like you to do something for me tomorrow. Visit your neighbors, your colleagues at work, wherever you may be going, somebody at the store, and walk up to them and say, did you know I'm austral? Well, you do live in southern West Virginia, don't you? So you're austral. You see, folks, I told you I have a brain-stretching ministry, but I also want you to know I can make dry bones fun. Hello? But let's start destroying this whole thing. Now, what we're going to do, though, is we're going to destroy the second one first because it's so simple and so easy. It'll take about 2 minutes, and we won't have to talk about the rest of the night. So let's talk about misrepresentations. Well, to debunk misrepresentations, here we see the drawing of the tooth of Nebraska Man. Now, this tooth was found in the state of Nebraska in 1922 by evolutionists. And they claimed that it was the tooth of a pre-human, subhuman living at some time in the distant past in what is now the state of Kansas and the areas of Nebraska, etc. And based upon this one tooth being found in 1922, an artist with the Illustrated London News actually drew what Nebraska man looked like. Also his friend or wife, I've never figured it out, his horses, his camels, and a club, all from one tooth. Oh, come on, that's pretty good, huh? All that from one tooth. I mean, that's really neat. The only problem with it is this. 5 years later, in 1927, evolutionists digging at the same location proved categorically it was not the tooth of an extinct species of prehuman or subhuman. It was, in fact, the tooth of an extinct species of pig. And so, actually, this is the tooth of porcine man. He was a real porker. Hey, look, take the one you like and throw the rest away. Is that fair enough? Yeah. But what is a misrepresentation? The tooth was real. You know, it wasn't a fake, a fraud, or anything like that. The tooth was real. But it was misidentified to begin with, misrepresented to begin with, and then later corrected. And that's all you need to know about misrepresentations. Real evidence, but misrepresented to begin with. But as science is supposed to be self-correcting, it was corrected later. And you don't need to know anything else about misrepresentations. But let's now go back to category number one, hoaxes. Now, first of all, what is a hoax? Well, it's not real. Yeah, I mean, a hoax is a fake, a fraud, not real, man-made, right? Well, let's talk about Piltdown Man. The fragments of Piltdown Man were found in 1912 in the deep southeast corner of England near Canterbury Cathedral, one of the oldest and most recognized cathedrals in Christianity. And the area the bones were found in made the name Piltdown, because that's an English terminology. And so it was called Piltdown Man. 1912, 1913, the bones were collected, sent to the British Museum of Natural History in London, and claimed to be proof of a prehuman, subhuman living at some time in the distant past in deep southeast England. That was 1912. And they continued to tell the people that until 1953. But in 1953, they finally had to admit this was a hoax. It's a fraud. It's a fake. It's man-made. It ain't real. Hello? Y'all do understand, ain't real, right? Let's just take a little look. You see, this is a drawing of the skull fragments of Piltdown Man. Now, they claimed that this was proof of human evolution in 1912. But in 1953, the evolutionists at the British Museum of Natural History finally admitted to the public that the jaw was not human. It was actually that of a 10 to an 11-year-old orangutan that had died about 500 years ago and probably lived in Borneo. The teeth are not human. They are, in fact, fossil chimpanzee teeth, and I will show you the real pictures, but take a look at the molars. They are absolutely flat. And the reason is, these are chimpanzee bones, teeth, that have been filed down with a modern metal file to make them appear more human in appearance, but they are actually chimpanzee teeth that have been filed down with a modern metal file. You can even see metal filings in the teeth. The skull fragments are, in fact, human, but there's a blow at the back of the skull here from a modern steel pickaxe, and today we know that this is a skull dug out of a medieval graveyard. Hello? It's a hoax. Now let me show you the real pictures. Now here, notice how flat the molars are because they've been filed down with a modern metal file. The jaw, again, is an orangutan and about 500 years old. But I would like you to remember this if you could. You see, in 1912 they were found, but the evolutionists at the British Museum of Natural History knew it was a hoax in 1923. But they didn't tell the public for 30 years. Don't you love the integrity of evolutionists? Come on, you can say yes. Yes, you know. Yeah, and you're going to find out evolutionists love 30 years. I'll explain that a little later. But they didn't tell the public for 30 years, even though they knew it was a hoax in 1923. And again, you've got to look at the integrity of these people. But just to review, what do we have? Oh, by the way, I want to mention two people. You need to remember these if you can. Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, Jesuit priest, and Dr. Davidson Black, PhD in human evolution. these two men were involved with the finding of the bones in 1912. But again, you want to remember their names because you're going to see them again. But to review, it's a medieval human skull. It's about a 500-year-old orangutan jaw, probably from Borneo, and filed-down chimpanzee teeth, correct? How y'all doing? Well, let's take a little look. This is the methodology illustrated here of how evolutionists attempt to prove the evolution of anything. I don't care whether it's tomatoes, butterflies, elephants, people. It doesn't matter. This is their favorite method of proof, but it is the second worst method of proof in science. It's called the proof by ranking, R-A-N-K-I-N-G, ranking. Now, what does it mean to rank something? It means to put it in a logical order or a logical sequence. And it is their favorite method of proof of evolution, but it is the second worst method of proof in science. And this illustration, please understand, this comes from evolutionists. This is not a creationist diagram. I'm not afraid to use their stuff. So what do they do? Well, again, up here you see some skulls, correct? Illustrations. Since we're dealing here with the supposed evolution of humans from apes, we have two ape-like skulls up here. And notice what they do. They measure everything you can measure. Every possible measurement you can possibly measure, and then they do it six times. But once they've done that and make it look really scientific, what do they then do? They simply line the skulls up by size and shape. That is illustrated down here at the bottom. So here we see skulls A through F. The gorilla skull here is merely for comparison. It is not a part of the sequence. But we see the skulls A through F lined up by size and shape. And in the middle here, we have what's called a key or a legend. Now, this identifies what each of these six skulls illustrated here are supposed to represent, correct? So let's just see what they say. And again, I don't agree with this stuff, but skull A, that's Australopithecus, supposedly a 500,000 to 1,000,000 years old. So that simply means dead southern ape, correct? And supposedly a 500,000 to 1,000,000 years old. B here is Pithecanthropus erectus, supposedly 200 to 500,000 years old. C is Homo sapien, supposedly 100 to 200,000 years old. D is Neanderthal, supposedly 50 to 100,000 years old. E is Homo sapien variety Neanderthaliensis, supposedly 50,000 years old. And F is modern Homo sapien. Well, that's what they said, right? Now, I want to talk about number two here, number B. Pithecanthropus erectus. Do any of you remember being taught about a creature called Pithecanthropus erectus when you were in school? I mean, if you don't remember, it's okay. I just was wondering. No? Well, let me explain to you. When you study your Bible, you are studying about the life of the Theanthropos. Who is the Theanthropos? Well, in Greek, theos means God. Theology is the study of God, correct? Anthropos is the ancient word for man. The study of man is anthropology, correct? So when you study your Bible, you're actually studying about the life of the Theanthropos, the one who is 100% God and 100% man. That's Jesus Christ, correct? So who is the Pithecanthropus erectus? Well, pitha means ape, anthropos means man, erectus means walks upright. So this is the ape man who walks upright. See how simple this stuff is when you just break it down, right? Right? But if you do not remember studying in school about Pithecanthropus erectus, and that's fine, how many of you would know this creature by its common name, Java Man? Oh, all of a sudden people say, oh yeah, I remember Java Man. And we're not talking about Starbucks here either. Well, let's talk a minute about Java Man. You see, Java Man was originally called Pithecanthropus erectus, but today it has been changed to Homo erectus, meaning man who walks upright. The name has been changed to protect the guilty. And Well, this creature was made from a few teeth and a single skull cap found in 1891 along the banks of the Solo River in Java, Indonesia. They were found by the Dutch anatomist Dr. Eugene Dubois, M.D. However, this Dutch anatomist Dr. Dubois, he was a disciple of the German evolutionist Dr. Ernst Haeckel. Anybody remember Ernst Haeckel? No? He is arguably the third most important evolutionist behind Charles Darwin and Thomas Huxley. And he's an interesting guy. Now, he was born in Germany, of course, and raised in a what they called Christian home, but he was never a Christian. And he believed in evolution. He would go on to get a PhD in biology, and he would teach at Jena University for decades. However, when Charles Darwin published Origin of the Species in November of 1859, it was popular. The first edition sold out the first day. Now, why did his book sell out in one day with the first edition? It was quite simple. The English were trying to, they were trying to get rid of God. They were looking for any excuse to get rid of God, and Darwin's book gave them the excuse, thinking it was scientific. But that was so popular, it was translated into other European languages and eventually into German. And when Dr. Haeckel, who already believed in the concept of evolution, when he read Darwin, he became not just an evolutionist, he became a militant evolutionist. And he would go on to create great frauds in support of evolution. Now, I have a video on him. He's really worth knowing about. But I just want to explain to you, he came up with some frauds, fakes, you know, to promote evolution. One of them was a creature called Pithecanthropus allalis. Now, Pithecanthropus allalis means speechless ape man. Because Charles Darwin, Thomas Huxley, Ernst Haeckel, they believed the only significant difference between people and apes was we could talk and they couldn't. And so he made up this creature called Pithecanthropus allalis, the speechless ape man. And it's interesting, Dr. Haeckel was actually a very good artist, a rare thing amongst PhDs in science, I will tell you. But he really was a very good artist. His works still sell for significant money, but more from his historical than his art ability. However, he didn't do the drawing himself. He hired an artist to draw what this creature looked like. One male, one female, and a baby. Now the man, and I'm just going to illustrate what it looks like, the man is standing with his back slightly to the audience, his arms up like this. Now there's enough hair on this guy for three gorillas. And remember, Dr. Haeckel took this drawing and he went around Germany. Now, I know you're not going to believe this, but it's absolutely true. In the late 1800s, scientists could rent a hall, put up posters, and sell tickets to have people come and listen to them teach. Did y'all hear that? I said people will actually buy tickets to come hear a scientist speak. Anyway. But he had this drawing made, and the man, the male, is standing up with, like I said, there's enough hair for three gorillas, and his face is turned to the audience. Now, remember, Dr. Haeckel's German, and he's speaking to blue-collar German workers, convincing them of evolution. And isn't it kind of interesting, though? On the face of this creature, it has a German handlebar mustache. Kind of plays to the audience, you know. Now, the woman is sitting down with a very long, horse-like face. She's holding the baby. You can only see the top of the head. You can't see anything about the baby. But he said this was the creature from which all Europeans had evolved. To this day, not one piece of physical evidence has ever been found to prove the existence of this creature. He just made it up. Hello? And he made up other great frauds. I'm sure all of you came in here this morning, this evening, having thought about this when you got up. He came up with the idea of embryonic recapitulation. I'm sure all of you were thinking about this when you got up this morning, right? Yeah. It's also called phylogeny begets ontology. I don't reckon you probably remember that one either. However, I have the photographs in my book on Creation Outside. How many of you remember seeing drawings in your textbooks in the government-run schools? How many of you remember seeing drawings of embryos that all looked practically identical? And then below them, showing what the creatures eventually turned into. And this is called embryonic recapitulation. The idea was that in your mother's womb, you recapitulated. You lived through all the stages of your evolutionary past. And so he showed a human, chicken, salamander, etc. And he said, we all start out as embryos looking very much the same. As a matter of fact, near identical. And then we only change over time in our mother's womb. And so, as soon as you're conceived, you turn into a jellyfish. And then you become a fish in your mother's womb. And then you become an amphibian. And then a reptile, finally a mammal, and you're only born human. Hello? Any of you remember those drawings? I'll tell you something that's very startling to me. Those drawings are still being used in some college textbooks in the United States. A few years ago, I was teaching in an elite high school in Karelia. That's the area of Russia right next to Finland. These kids are smart. They are the best of the entire region. They work hard. They're really smart. And I had the opportunity to teach there two straight days. I spoke in every science classroom in the high school. And when I talked to one class about these drawings and the history of Ernst Haeckel, showing that it was an absolute fraud, you see, we've known that it's not true, and I'll explain how he did it, but once I disproved it, it was striking. In that area of Russia, there's a lot of genes that came from the Vikings, and the men and women are tall, blonde hair, blue-eyed, Viking-type genes, and at the end of the class, I had destroyed Haeckel's stuff, and they had been teaching it in the textbook. The teacher in the back had taught it. But one strikingly beautiful young lady got up, walked to the back of the classroom, looked down at the teacher who was in there and said, "And what are you going to teach us now?" I will never forget it. But we've known since 1915 it wasn't true. As a matter of fact, Dr. Haeckel stole the drawings of legitimate embryologists, and he then took a pencil and an eraser, and he erased some of the lines. He drew lines in that were never there. He changed the size as much as tenfold and claimed that we all looked alike at the beginning, but we differentiated in our mother's womb. It's an absolute lie. No embryologist today would ever believe it's true. But nonetheless, he made up this great fraud to convince people about evolution. I mean, this guy was a real piece of work. But he was the mentor of Dr. Eugene Dubois, who was Dutch. And of course, the Dutch and German languages are very similar. But the two of them so believed in evolution, they believed that if Dubois would go to Indonesia, which Java would be, in those days, the Dutch East Indies, correct? So it's the same thing as a Dutch part of the nation. But they believed that he would go out to Indonesia, he would find the missing link between man and ape. Now, I'd like to talk with you about your Christian commitment for just a moment. How strong is your Christian commitment? Because Dr. Dubois and Dr. Haeckel so believed in evolution. They believed that Dr. Dubois would go to Indonesia, he would find the missing link, correct? He was so committed to it, he volunteered to be a doctor in the Dutch army to get a free ticket to Indonesia. Come on, folks, that's commitment. And what happens? Now, he arrived in December of 1887. His archaeological team consisted of, I'm sure you're impressed by this, two Dutch engineers, prison convict laborers, and the two Dutch army corporals to watch the prisoners. Boy, ain't that a scientific team, right? Strikes confidence in you, doesn't it? But he finds these fragments, and he wants his mentor back in Germany to know that he's found the missing link, right? Now, you have to remember, Dubois would telegraph Dr. Haeckel in Germany. But, of course, in 1891, that's very expensive. You know, we don't have any really young people here. I would point out they had no cell phones in 1891. Hello? Well, he has to send a telegram. I mean, how many of y'all remember telegrams, right? If you don't, when I arrived in Russia in the 1990s, they were still using telegraphs. Oh, yes. You went down to the post office to make a phone call. Yeah, absolutely true. But it's very expensive because they charge you per character, you know? And it's halfway around the world. So he sends a short cryptic telegram to Dr. Haeckel back in Germany telling him, you know, Eureka, I've found it, right? And Dr. Haeckel wants to send him a telegram of congratulations and back, right? But again, it's expensive, and so it's short. But I thought you might like to see the text. This is the telegram that Dr. Haeckel sent from Germany back to Dr. Dubois in Indonesia. From the inventor of Pithecanthropus to his happy discoverer. Maybe I need to read that again. From the inventor of Pithecanthropus to his happy discoverer. You see, Dr. Haeckel had already made up the name. He sent Dubois there to find pieces to go with it. Is that right? But Dr. Dubois forgot to tell anybody a couple of things about his discovery. And he didn't tell them for, I'll bet you know, 30 years. But in 1921, not long before he passed away, Dr. Dubois admitted the truth, as I share it to you now. You see, he had actually found a large ape-like skull cap. Today we think it's a giant gibbon. He had found three teeth, but only one was human. The other two were from an orangutan. 1 year later, in 1892, he would find a human thigh bone, as illustrated here, 50 feet away from the skull cap where he found it. But all he had in 1891 were three teeth and a single skull cap. And he claimed that this proved human evolution from apes. He also forgot to tell anybody that 1 year earlier, in 1890, he had found two totally normal human skulls at the same location. But he didn't tell anybody for 30 years. He was so concerned that anybody would find out about these two totally normal human skulls, he hid them under his bed. So let's think about this. What do we actually have here? Remember that Pithecanthropus erectus, now called Homo erectus, that's a fake, that's a fraud, correct? Oh, so let's take a look. What do we have here? Well, A is Australopithecus, dead southern ape, correct? B is something that never existed, that's a hoax. C is Homo sapien. Now, the last time I looked, that's us, correct? And D is Neanderthal, but they have always been classified as Homo sapiens since they were first found. So that's us. E is Homo sapien variety Neanderthaliensis, which of course would be us. And finally, skull F is modern Homo sapien, which is most assuredly us. So let's think what we got here. One dead southern ape, something that never existed, and four people. How y'all doing? The proof by ranking actually proves nothing, as I will show you. Now, let me prepare you. I will show you pictures of some skulls. I just wanted you to know, because I know some of you probably had dinner before you got here. Just warning you, okay? For instance, this is a picture of a skull identified as Peking Man, the technical name Sinanthropus pekinensis, but Sino is China, China Man. From Peking is the actual scientific name, right? I find that skull picture right there scary. And I mean that. I find that very scary. Not because of the skull at all, but because of the source of the photograph. Take a look down here. It's from Stones and Bones, Los Angeles, California, school district. That's what I find scary about the whole thing. Now, there's a whole series of these photographs, and what I find particularly scary about them is the whole series is used to teach elementary school children they evolved from apes. Again, that's what I find scary. Now, I'm only going to show you two pictures from the series, but there's a whole series of them. However, I'm going to stop and simply ask, does anybody have a problem with me showing the photograph of the skull of Peking Man? Nobody has a problem. That's interesting. You see, you actually should stand up and stone me, because that is not the photograph of the skull of Peking Man. That is actually the photograph of the model of the skull of Peking Man. Let me tell you about Peking men. Now, this is not the original bones. This is simply museum quality reproduction of original pieces. Because, you know, when you go to a museum, they never let you see the real thing. You know, you always are just seeing plastic models because the real ones are considered too important and they're locked away in vaults. You know, if you walked over to a dinosaur skeleton and so forth, some of the bones might be real, and then you knock on some of them and they would simply be plastic. Now, tell me something. This is a museum reproduction of the bones that were actually found, but does that look like this? Okay, so this is a model and then photographed, but that's what they found. I think I see a little difference. How about you? Oh, and what is the story about Peking men? After World War I, 1923, evolutionists went to China. They went to what was then the capital, Peking, now Beijing. But they went to Peking, got permission to go out near Peking, north of the capital, and start archaeological digs. The archaeological digs would last from 1923 to 1937. But when the Japanese invaded Manchuria, the work had to be stopped. It was obvious that Japanese were going to go right straight into China, and it was too dangerous to continue the work, correct? Now, with that in mind, you see, Davidson Black, do you remember him? He was one of the two guys that was involved with Piltdown Man. Oh, well, Davidson Black is the one who actually named the creature Peking Man, but it was made from just these pieces, as you see here, but these are not the real pieces. But the work had to be stopped in 1937 when the Japanese invaded Manchuria. Now, remember that the Japanese invasion of China was massive. And his fellow anthropologists from around the world begged him, said, oh, you cannot allow these precious pieces to, you know, fall into the hands of the advancing Japanese army. You must allow them to be shipped out of China. And so 4 years later, in 1941, the pieces were photographed, carefully packaged up, shipped out of China, and promptly lost. The original pieces have never been seen again. What you saw were just models from the photographs. And I would like to remind you that in 1926, Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, Jesuit priest, and Dr. Davidson Black, PhD, were involved and had gone to China, and that's when Davidson Black named the creature Peking Man. So the people that were involved with the hoax at Piltdown were also involved with the hoax of Peking Man. Today it is commonly accepted in the scientific community. They salted both locations. How y'all doing? I would also like to point something out. Remember I said how Java Man had been renamed Homo erectus, the man who walks upright, correct? Now, I have Dr. Grady's 101 Great Scientific Truths. One of them is this. The name Homo erectus is used by evolutionists today as a file 13. It's a garbage bin. It's a hole in the ground. Whenever they find anything that they believe has anything to do with human evolution, but they cannot prove it, they throw it into this circular filing cabinet, this garbage bin called Homo erectus. Hello? Now, let's take a look at the second picture I will show you from the same series. Now, here we see the photograph of the skull of a Neanderthal. It is a real picture of a real skull, but it has a French name because this was found in France. Now, of course, Neanderthals were first found in Germany, but later then in France and other places. I am going to show you a map where Neanderthals have been found, their remains. I am still looking for a more current map, so I'm going to have to add one thing to this map. But it's the most current map I can find. You see, we have found slightly over 400 different individuals, not complete skeletons of over 400, but partial skeletons of over 400 individuals. Now, first of all, that's not a whole lot, would you agree? Come on, that's just a neighborhood, right? But they were first found in Germany in 1856, and I thought that perhaps here tonight you might be interested to know, those especially involved with the music ministry, where did the name Neanderthal come from? In German, Tal means valley. Neander was the last name of a man who owned the valley. His first name was Noam Neander. He owned that valley. And that's where the bones were first found. But he was a writer of Christian hymns. Just thought you might like to know. Now, this map is the most current map I can find, but I will make one addition to it. I really wish I could find a newer map. But Neanderthals were first found in Germany, of course, but more were actually found in France than Germany. They've also been found in Spain, Portugal, northern Italy, the Adriatic. Neanderthals have been found in caves in northern Israel near Tel Dan, at the foot of Mount Hermon, here. But they've also been found east of the Black Sea, east of the Caspian, out into central Siberia here. But I'm going to add one more find. A few years ago, now, I know it's difficult to see, it really is, but if you can make out over here, there's an image, it looks like a banana standing upright. It's Lake Baikal. Now, a few months ago, I was walking on it. Hey, look, it's easy to walk on water if it's frozen. And I was walking on it 2 years ago, too. There's 10 inches of ice. It is the world's single largest body of fresh water. There is more fresh water in Lake Baikal than all other lakes, ponds, etc. combined in the world. It is a beautiful, beautiful thing, I can tell you. You can see east to west across it from any place, but you cannot see the north end from the south end. It's that big. And it's the largest source of fresh water in the entire world. And it is absolutely beautiful. But if you could make it out, it really is right here. Now, east of the Baikal, over here, there's a city called Chita. Now, I have taught in Russia all the way to the Pacific, but there's a city there called Chita. I've been there twice, and near that city is where the most recent Neanderthal finds have been found. So that means that Neanderthals went all the way from the Atlantic, all the way across Europe, all the way across Asia, all the way to almost the Pacific. And of course, Neanderthals are the ones that most people want you to think are ape gorilla-like. They'll you know, if you've seen particularly the older drawings of them, they tend to make them hunched over, semi-ape, semi-human-like, and so forth. But they were actually 100% human. Now, I'm going to share a few things with you just to point that out. Now, number one, they had a brain 13% larger than ours on average today. I think that makes it a little hard to suggest they're pre-human or subhuman. How about you? Come on, they got a brain 13% larger than ours? I think it's a little hard, don't you? Number two, they are, and we have the genetic information to prove, 99.7 to 100% identical to modern humans today. We've actually extracted DNA from finger bones and from teeth roots of Neanderthals, and they are 99.7% the same as us or closer. I would point out to you that human beings can actually vary by as much as 4.5%. We do not all have the same amount of DNA. And we can vary by as much as 4.5% in our DNA and still be 100% human. So that means that Neanderthals vary less from us than we do from ourselves. Hello? And number three, you will find them in the Bible. Please take a look at Genesis chapter 10, verse 3. Genesis chapter 10, verse 3. And look for the name Ashkenaz. Ashkenaz. Now, remember that God had one population of people that were very homogeneous. But at the Tower of Babel experience, there's approximately 140,000 people alive, and God divided them by language barriers into 40 groups, correct? And those 40 groups then migrated across the earth. The name Ashkenaz you see there is the name associated anciently with North Central Europe. It's the ancient name associated with Germany. And if you know about these things, in Judaism in Europe, there are two branches of Judaism in Europe. There's the Spanish Jews called the Sephardic Jews. But the North European Jews are called the Ashkenazi. And even today, when Jews make Aliyah, the return to the land of Israel from the area of Germany, they are still today called the Ashkenazi. Now, who are the Neanderthals? They are the descendants of Ashkenaz who migrated to north central Germany area, and they lived in caves, probably for no more than 200 years. Certainly, the 400 individuals we have found would only support 100 or 2 years, and once they had learned how to establish themselves in that environment, they left the caves behind. But as I'm about to show you, they didn't just live in caves. Today we now know they had language, they had art, they had music, they made jewelry, they were religious, they buried their dead in religious graves with religious artifacts. In addition to that, they hunted and gathered, as are portrayed by most evolutionists. But recent research has proven they didn't just hunt and gather. In fact, in 2015, we proved that they farmed. And in 2017, we proved that they made a sophisticated adhesive. You may not realize that a good glue is a big technological advancement, because you have to have a good glue to hold arrowheads and spearheads on. And so this is a big technological advancement. Also, however, in 2020, we proved that they also built houses. They didn't just live in caves. But you have to admit, actually, living in a cave is a very intelligent thing to do, especially if you're living in Northern Europe. After all, they are warm in the winter, cool in the summer, and incredibly cheap to build. Agreed? And, when people hear about my beliefs on creation and so forth, often there's a question, well, are cavemen, and by the way, I want to mention cave women, you know, I want to be inclusive here, are cavemen and cave women biblical? That is a question that often comes up. So to start the answer on that, please tell me, if God starts the Bible on day one, week one, month one, year one, is there any such thing as prehistoric? Okay, I'll repeat the question. If God starts the Bible on day one, week one, month one, year one, is there any such thing as prehistoric? There is no, thank you, by the way, not a chance, that was good. But there is no such thing as prehistoric. Is a word invented by evolutionists, but technically it is a non-word because it has no definition. Nothing is prehistoric. Everything is historic. Hello? And if you will read your Bibles, you're going to find out that cavemen, and again, cave women, are in fact biblical. Because if you will study your Bibles, you will actually find that there are 31 references to men and women living in caves. Now, I'm just going to give you a few references. Don't want to take the time to read everything, but just some of the references of the 31. But you can find them with a concordance in your Bible anytime you want to. But just to give you some illustrations, if we go to Genesis 19:30, Lot and his daughters lived in a cave. Or if we go to Joshua 10:17, the five Amorite kings were found in a cave. Or what about Judges 6, the children of Israel were in mountains and caves. Or what about Samson? Now, Samson is a judge of Israel. He is one of those people before the kings, but he is equal to a king with his authority. And Samson, well, he lived in a cave. That's recorded for us in Judges 15:8. So doesn't that qualify Samson as a caveman? Hello? Or what about Elijah? The great prophet Elijah lived in a cave. The fact of the matter is, we even think we know the cave that he did live in, although I admit there was no brass plaque when we found it, okay? But we think we actually know the cave he lived in by description. But the great prophet Elijah lived in a cave, so doesn't that qualify Elijah as a caveman? Thank you. Keep going. And Obadiah's 100 prophets in 1 Kings 18, 4, and 13. Or the men of Israel at Michmash, 1 Samuel 13:6. And do I not seem to remember? King David lived in the cave of Adullam, recorded in 1 Samuel 22 and 1 Samuel 24. So doesn't that qualify King David as a caveman? And if you'd like a New Testament reference, Please tell me. You know the Apostle Paul, of course, who was Saul of Tarsus, who was a persecutor of the church, correct? And he was going to Damascus to persecute the church in Syria, and he meets the Lord on the road to Damascus, correct? He is struck blind. He will go to Damascus. His sight will be given back to him. He will return briefly to Jerusalem. And then what did he do? Doesn't the Bible say he went out into the deserts of Arabia and was taught only of the Holy Spirit for 3 straight years? In the desert, where do you think he lived? In a cave. You see, Israel, the Arabian Peninsula, is honeycombed with literally tens of thousands of caves. There have been hermits, monasteries, etc., there for literally millennia. And so I find it interesting, don't you? I mean, Paul writes about the institution of communion, and he writes about it in first person. But we know he wasn't there, because at the time that Jesus gave us communion, what we call the Last Supper, he was a persecutor of the church, correct? So we know he wasn't there. But when he writes about it, he puts it in first person, is that correct? Now, I'd just like to share a little vision with you of how I think this all went down. You know, he left Jerusalem, went out, found a very nice, comfortable cave. And then I think what happened was the Holy Spirit brought in a 55-inch flat-screen TV and played videos of the life of Jesus for 3 years. It's just a thought, you know. But, cavemen and cavewomen are definitely biblical. Is that correct? Now, I want to talk with you about the proof by ranking. What does it really prove? Earlier I said it doesn't prove anything, and that's exactly correct. But I want to debunk this and illustrate for you. It is the second worst method of proof in science, but it is the most favorite method of proof by evolutionists. Remember, to rank means to line things up by size and shape. That's to rank things, correct? Now, I want to do a little experiment here tonight to prove my point. So I want you to understand, I do not want you to stand up, just sit there, take your notes and so forth, right? Be comfortable. But what if, okay? What if I were to ask you to stand up, come down here to the front and join us, and what I'm going to do is I'll take the shortest, because I know who that is right over there, I'm going to take the shortest, put her over here, and I'm going to line us up across the front here by our height only, okay? So I'm going to start with the shortest down there, the tallest up here with me and so forth, and once I have everybody in this room lined up by your height, from the shortest over there to the tallest over here, tell me, what two things did I prove scientifically? Now remember, there's no trick questions here. I did prove two things scientifically by doing this. Now what are they? I'll take them in either order. It doesn't matter to me. Well, I mean, some of you kind of got the answer, but I'm going to put it in a more scientific terminology. Would that be okay? I have just proved that people come in different heights, right? What is the second thing I proved scientifically? No? I just proved that I have the intelligence to do it. I just proved that people come in different heights, and I have the intelligence to put them in a logical order, a rank. Is that correct? Now, in science, what we do is exactly the same thing, but we change one thing and one thing only when we do experiments. So again, I'm not asking you to stand up, but if I did ask you to stand up, and I brought you down here to the front, and I'm going to line you up from that wall to this wall over here by the month and the day of your birth only. I don't care how old you are. I don't care what year you were born. I don't care what your gender is. I don't care what your height is. Just want to know what is the month and the day of the month you were born. So I'm going to start with January 1st over there, and end up with December 31 over here. And once I have lined everybody here in the room here up in a rank from January 1 to December 31, what two things have I scientifically proved? Oh, come on, one's a gimme. Well, I have proved that people are born on different days of the year. And? I have the intelligence. Thank you, my dear. Bless you. All over. Real good. Okay? Bless your Lord. Now, but please tell me, lining you up by your height only, or lining you up by the month and day of your birth only, did I prove anything about your heritage? Did I prove that any two of you are married to each other? Did I prove that any of you are father, son, mother, daughter? Aunts, uncles, nieces, nephews, or cousins? No. The proof by ranking proves absolutely nothing. Hello? But they use it to deceive you all the time. And I don't care whether it's dinosaurs, roses, butterflies, etc. Now, another thing too, happening to know a little bit about West Virginia. Now, remember, I went to high school in the District of Columbia, and I used to come over here all the way back into, as a matter of fact, I drove through West Virginia in 1961. And, well, what if I were to go out in the woods around here, and I found the skeleton of a dead deer, which had died from old age, of course. Now, if there's enough bones there, I would be able to prove whether it was male or female. But I have to have some certain bones and or teeth. But please tell me, when I find the skeleton of a dead deer in the woods, can I prove it ever had offspring? Come on, folks. I could not prove it ever had children, is that correct? I might be able to tell it was male or female, but I'd have to have certain bones. I might, with the teeth, be able to tell how old it was within 1 year of the actual age, but I couldn't even prove it had offspring, is that correct? You see, I want to make sure these people never deceive you again. I have a proposition for you. Do you know what I mean by a proposition? I'm not talking about gambling, okay? Just a proposition for you. Here's my proposition. You give me one skull each of 1,000 real animals. So we're talking about, give me the skull of a rat, a cat, a dog, a cow, a horse. Are you with me? One real skull of 1,000 different real animals, okay? And using this methodology, I will prove to you that apes did not evolve into people. I will prove to you that apes actually evolved into whales. Or I'll go through, pick out skulls, line them up in a series, and prove to you that apes did not evolve into people. What really happened was apes evolved into elephants. Hello? You let me pick and choose the skulls. I'll line them up in a sequence that will make it appear that that's what happened. Well, with that in mind, I want to go on with this. You see, I only ask the good questions. Hello? Yeah, I only ask the good questions. Here's my next question. Which proof by ranking are we supposed to believe is the correct one? Let me explain. We're going to take a look at which proof by ranking is the one we should believe is true, that people evolved into apes. I have a whole series of these, but for instance, this comes from the Smithsonian in Washington, D.C. Now, when I went to high school there, I used to do my high school homework at the Library of Congress. Did I tell you I'm serious? But I used to go down to the Smithsonian, particularly Natural History Museum. I used to just soak myself in the evolution down there at that museum because it was just a 10-cent bus ride, you know? But this comes from their own website. And I'm going to just describe what we have here, just enough so that you know. And once you know what's there, you will be able to disprove the whole thing for yourself. So what do we see here? Well, on the right is the present. That's today on the right. And then going back to the left, supposedly going back in time, and going back in 1 million year increments. So 1 million, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 million, right? And inside here, we have these bars, different colors, of course, you notice that. But we have these various bars, and next to each bar is the name of the creature it is supposed to represent when they came into existence and when they became extinct. For example, how many of you are familiar with the very famous fossil Lucy? Anybody know about Lucy? Yeah, Australopithecus afarensis, found by Dr. Donald Johansson in 1975. Well, that's Lucy right there in the middle. So supposedly Lucy evolved into existence about 4 million years ago and then, well, evolved out, became extinct about 3 million, and you see the bar here, right? So each bar has a name next to it representing what's supposed to be, and over here we have Homo sapien, and here's Lucy, and so on. You now know everything you need to know to completely debunk this all for yourself. But since I'm up front, what if I go first? Would that be all right? Well, first of all, did you notice no two solid bars touch each other? Is that correct? The solid bars are connected with dotted lines. Is that correct? Now tell me, why do we connect things with dotted lines? Well, we connect things with dotted lines when we're trying to show a relationship that we think might be right, but we can't prove it. So we use dotted lines in trying to connect things that we think might be, but we can't prove it. Is that correct? And notice here, things are connected with dotted lines. Do you see any solid lines touching each other? Well, no. Number two, I was wondering if you would count the question marks with me, all right? So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 question marks. Boy, doesn't that just strike confidence in you? Come on, 5 question marks, right? I was also wondering if you happened to notice. Did you notice these two back here? And these three here. Now, there's a question mark here, but these two and these three right here. Notice that there are no dotted lines connecting any of these to humans. Is that correct? So why are they there? Remember, I only asked the good questions, and there's a very good answer. But why are these two and these three there when there are no dotted lines connecting them to humans? One word describes why there's no dotted lines there. Well, if you can't figure it out, would you please repeat one word after me? Would you please repeat the word filler? Come on, filler. Come on, say it loud, say it proud. Filler. Why are they there? Because they needed filler. Think with me, if you erase those 5, it looks like there's less evidence for human evolution, correct? So this is magic, this is deception, this is illusion. They put the 5 in there because they wanted filler. How are we doing so far? We're doing good? And then I said, which proof by ranking are we supposed to believe is the correct one? Because if you look carefully, there's 2 different ones here. Notice, you can go from humans back this way to here, but then we don't know where it came from, correct? Or we could go back this way and still get to the same point, is that correct? So which of the two are we supposed to believe is right? Do you start to see what I'm saying? You can debunk the whole thing. I would also point out to you that these 5, October 2013, evolutionists said all 5 of these are one kind. That they're just variations within a kind, just as no two of us look exactly alike. And in one day, in 2013, they lost 4 intermediates. How y'all doing? Is this stuff good? I hope so, because I like it. Let's take a look at another one. Now, I have to explain this one to you. This one was up and down, and it was so tall, I cut it in half and put one side next to the other. But that was so you could actually see it, because otherwise it was so small you couldn't see it. But I was able to magnify it by cutting it in half and putting it side by side. So what do we have? This is the present here. That's today. And then we start going back in time, supposedly. But notice these 4 right here are those 4 right there. So this connects right there and then continues on down, correct? Again, it's supposedly 6 million years. But again, let's take a look at this and let's just see if we can't debunk this whole thing tonight. I want to point out that the people who did this particular presentation were actually rather honest evolutionists. And there are people who are honest evolutionists. But let's just take a look. First of all, you see all the solid bars. And they all have names next to them, correct? And again, this is Lucy right here. And, well, number one, you notice they're connected with dotted lines, correct? Ah. But I was wondering if you could help me count the question marks here, okay? So let's see. We got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and I've missed one someplace. There's more than that, but so many question marks. Boy, doesn't it just impress you? Come on, that's really, hello. But I wondered if you happened to notice, again, notice the little one here and these over here, because that's these here, right? So these 3 are these 3, the little one there is that one, right? So notice that these four have no dotted lines going to humans, correct? So why are they there? Come on, come on, say it loud, say it proud. Feller! But I said that the evolutionists who drew this were honest evolutionists, and I want to compliment them for that. Did you happen to notice there are no dotted lines connecting these three to any of this? There's no dotted line here connecting these three to any of these. Well, I want to point out again to you that in 2013, these were all declared to be the same thing, just a variety of them, right? But I have one more to show you. This comes from my beloved University of California, Berkeley, where I grew up as a child. And this comes directly off of their website. And again, we see the concept of human evolution from apes. And again, we're back to where the present is on the right side. And you go back in 1 million year increments, back 6 million years. Now, you'll notice we have the bars, we have the names, correct? And they even decorated it with skulls. Isn't that neat? Come on, that's really neat, right? But did you happen to notice the evolutionists at Berkeley were so honest, they didn't even use dotted lines? Hello? There's no dotted lines connecting any of them, is that right? Now, notice, if you will, right back here, it says 6 million years ago, chimpanzees broke off of the human line and went that away. Now, I sort of asked you about this on Sunday. You've heard, not believed, but you've heard that chimpanzees, people share 96, 97, 98, 99% of the same DNA, correct? But you'll notice that here it clearly shows that chimpanzees broke off of the human line 6 million years ago, correct? And they say chimpanzees have nothing to do with us, right? Well, I have another piece of information to share with you. You see, June 13, 2011, Science Magazine, the second highest scientific journal in the world for evolutionists, said that no, the chimpanzees did not break off from the line of human evolution 6 million years ago. They broke off 13 million years ago. In one day, they pushed the separation of chimpanzees from humans back by 7 million years in one day. How y'all doing? And again, I would point out to you, they classified these as all the same thing as well in 2013. Now, we are nearing the close. I promise those of you that would come here instead of the restaurant on a Tuesday night discount would get a lot of fun tonight. You have most fun you have them all week, and I promise that. I mean it. I think you're going to shake my hand when you leave and say thank you. Now, you know I'm a missionary. I travel all over the world, etc. And I was in an airport, and I was walking down the hall past a magazine rack, and I saw that cover of Time magazine. Now, you don't have to believe me. You can find this yourself on the internet. This is the front cover of Time magazine, October the 9th, 2006. Now, remember that the single biggest propagandizer of evolution to the population is National Geographic. But Time magazine comes right in around second. Everything Time magazine publishes is evolutionary. Now, I'm walking down the hall in this airport, and I can walk at full speed, and because I'm a trained observer, I can see things walking at full speed many people would miss completely. And I'm walking full speed down the hallway, I glance over there, I see this cover, and I came to a dead stop in two steps. I backed up and I looked at it real good, and I got angry. I got real angry. But the Bible says you can get angry and sin not, is that correct? If you have a righteous anger, is that correct? And I got real angry. But it was a righteous anger. Take a look at the Time cover here. Notice again that everything they do is evolutionary, but on the cover they have a human baby and a young chimpanzee, correct? And on the cover it says, how we became human, always promoting evolution. However, at the bottom of the page, there's this white print down here. Now, I don't expect you to be able to read that, so what I'm going to do is, I'm going to copy it word for word over here for you to see it. So right here below how we became human, right there it says, and I quote, chimps and humans share almost 99% of their DNA. New discoveries reveal how we can be so alike and yet so different. And that's what it says right there on the cover, correct? I looked at that and I got seriously, righteously angry because I knew it was a bold-faced lie. It is a bold-faced lie. Now, what I did was I went home and I did the research. Today I have 67 reasons it's not true. Relax, we're not going to do all 67 tonight. What I have done, though, is I have boiled it down to just a few bullet points for you, easy to understand. So what we're going to look at is, do apes and people share 96 to 99% of the same DNA? Please notice I have citations down here for almost everything. And again, I'm going to just summarize why this is not true. And point number one is very simple. Remember that similarity may come from a common ancestor, which would be evolution, but similarity can also come from a common designer, creator, God. I want you to stop for a moment and look at your hand. I mean it, just look at your hand. This is called the pendactyl pattern, the five-digit pattern. Now, when you look at your hand, those are the exact same bones that are in your foot. They are the exact same bones in the wing of a bird, the flipper of a whale, the leg of a horse. You see, we teach this in engineering universities. You come up with one really good design, and then you modify it to do many things. This is a terrific design. And what is it designed for? It is designed to grasp things. I hope you understood that, grasp things. So we can use it to grasp an object, but a bird uses it to grasp air. A whale uses it to grasp water. The horse uses it to grasp the ground. But it's a really good design. And all those bones are exactly the same. The only difference is size and length. But they're the exact same bones. And so evolutionists say, this is because we have a common ancestor. But the creation says, no, it's because we've got an infinitely knowledgeable creator God who can come up with a really good design and then modify it for many different uses. Now, point number two. Humans have 23 pairs of chromosomes, but gorillas, chimpanzees, bonobos, and orangutans have 24. Apes have an extra pair of chromosomes we don't even have. Please tell me, does that make them better than us? Excuse me? No, it doesn't make them better than us. Is that right? Oh. Now, this one should be pretty convincing to all of you. The Y chromosome. The Y chromosome is the gender chromosome for men. Now, when I come along with something that I think might be particularly interesting to the women, I try to help the ladies. Didn't I last night, ladies? Come on. Hello. The bling, right? Remember that? But now I have something for the men. Remember that in human beings, women have two X chromosomes for gender. Men have one X and one Y chromosome, which is why boy ends with Y. It's easy to remember that that's the male chromosome in English. But men, I want you to think about this. Men, you know, women have two X chromosomes for gender. We have one X and one Y, correct? Now, guys, this is why women are a doubly unknown quantity to men. Come on, X is an unknown quantity, and they got two. But notice I have citations here from Nature magazine, the single highest scientific journal in the world for evolutionists. The Y chromosomes are, in people, men, and apes, are, and I quote, horrendously different from each other. We are different, guys, from male chimps and other apes by 58% different. We are 58% different in the male gender gene. Now, ladies, you're a little closer, but you're only 69% the same as apes. But think with me, men, we have 60 genes for gender. Male chimps only have 25. Ladies, female chimps are only 31% different than you. Sorry. But let me ask you a question. They're trying to sell you that apes and people are only 1% different. I love doing mission work in the UK. I've spoken in the Republic of Ireland, Northern Ireland, Wales, England, Scotland. And I love doing it. I just love it because they speak English. We don't speak English. We speak American. It's a dialect. Hello. But I love going over there because they speak real English, you know. And the English have some wonderful expressions they use. And one of their expressions is, let's do the maths. Yeah, let's do the maths. They mean, let's do the mathematics. Let's do the arithmetic, okay? Now, men, if we are more than 58% different in the male gender genes, and ladies, you are 31% different for the female gender genes, how can we only be 1% different? Hello? But let's continue. You see, the chimpanzee genome, that's all of the genetic information contained in the DNA. Well, the chimpanzee genome is 11.5% larger than ours. We have 3 billion base pairs. They have 3.35 billion base pairs. They have 11.5% more genetic information in their genome than we do. Now, knowing that, and again, I stressed that humans can be as much as 4.5% different in total amount of DNA. But think with me. If their genome is 11.5% larger than ours, let's do the maths. How can that only be 1%? They really want to talk to you, dear. You know, if we were in the classroom, I would say that had better be God. Well, page 2, there's only 4 pages. Page 2, well, again, looking at this question, and again, I'm citing things like Nature magazine, the single highest scientific journal in the world for evolutionists. In the year 2000, the comparison between apes and people was at 95.2%. But think with me, we didn't know the ape genome, and we didn't know the human genome completely. And that number 99, do you know how they got it and started publicizing it? You know how they got it? Well, I'll explain. Just look at me for just a second. This is how they got it. There was no scientific backing for 99%. They just made it up. But in the year 2000, we didn't know the ape genome, and we were still working on the human genome. That was not complete until April of 2003. And based on only the little bit of information we had, it was already down to 95.2. So tell me, how come 6 years later, Time magazine could say it was 99? Hello? Could it be maybe they didn't want to know the truth? Maybe they didn't do the research? Maybe they had an agenda. Could that possibly be? But in April of 2003, we completed the Human Genome Project. We now know every letter in the alphabet of the human genome. But in 2003, we still did not know all the numbers and characters in the ape genome, right? But in 2003, it wasn't 99, it was down to 95.2. However, remember that there are only 4 DNA bases, and so all life on Earth, I'm talking, I don't care whether you're a bacteria, a bird, a human, we all share 25% the same DNA. You do not start comparing at zero. If you're going to use this ridiculous method of comparison, you have to start at 25. Hello? Oh. And remember that genetic similarity does not produce spiritual equivalency. Is that correct? I hope you heard that one really good. Well, we have only 2 more pages to go. Point number 8. I want to introduce you to Dr. Jerry Bergman. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I've got 4 degrees, 2 doctorates. Dr. Bergman has 2 doctorates, but he has 9 earned degrees. I don't know about you, but that humbles me. Hello. But his specialty is biology and microbiology, and I got news for you. The good news is he's one of us. He's a Christian creation scientist who believes in a young earth. Now, he specializes in biology and microbiology. So what did he do? He went out and he looked at the 2 single largest catalogs of known mutations from plants, bacteria, people, animals, but the 2 largest catalogs of known catalog mutations in the world, totaling roughly 500,000. But he could only find 186 mutations that were not lethal or detrimental. He could not find one mutation that was beneficial. But evolutionists say that mutations are what cause progressive upward increase in intelligence or complexity by random chance. Is that correct? But scientifically, what does the word mutation mean? Scientifically, the word mutation means copying error. Copying error. I want you to think what happens in genetics. You copy the previously existing information. You pass it on into the next generation in new combinations of information, but never new information. Did you hear that? Now, when you copy something, you have only two choices, correct? You can copy it perfectly, but if you copy it perfectly, there is no change, correct? What is the only other way you can copy something? You can copy it perfectly or imperfectly. Is it possible to copy something more perfectly? No. So you can either copy it perfectly or imperfectly. You cannot get an increase in intelligence or complexity by random chance, because mutations are the only thing in nature that evolution say can change this information, and it always goes downhill. And I want to point out, the 186, they used to call them neutral mutations. Today they're called functional mutations, but they have no net benefit, but they have no net detrimental thing either. But if you do the maths, remember that one? If you do the maths, that means that 99.96% of all mutations are harmful or lethal. In the long run, there is no such thing as a beneficial mutation. And if there seems to be a benefit from a mutation, it is not because something new or better came into existence. It's because the creature became defective. Yeah, it lost information. It didn't gain it. Now, humans and chimpanzees, apes, only share 29% of the same proteins. 71% of our proteins are different. So please tell me, if 71% of our proteins are different, let's do the maths. How can we only be 1% different? And considering the whole genome of humans, which we knew in 2003, but we still didn't know the entire genome of apes, the number was down to 86.7% similar. You'll notice the more we learn, the more we know we're different. Is that correct? Now, in 2003, the number was down to 86.7%. Please tell me, how could, 3 years later, Time magazine say it was 1%? Could it be they didn't want to know the truth, didn't want to do the studies, maybe they had an agenda? Could that possibly be the case? Well, page four, the last page for tonight before we leave. Considering the whole genome of apes and people, which was known in September of 2005, the number was down to 80.6 similar. The more we know, the more we know we're different, correct? But I want to bring this up to date. Now, this is up to date. As of December of 2013, now that's 9 years ago, right? As of that date, the number is now 70%. You are only 70% the same genetically as apes. But that number is not going to change because we know the information in both now 100%. It's not going to change. We are 70% the same as apes, and that number will not change. But now, I told you if you would stay for the last few minutes that you'd have more fun than you're going to have all week, right? Please notice that my fingers never leave my hands. I want you to know, based on this absolutely ludicrous method of comparison, that you are 50% the same as a banana. I don't know about you, I find that appealing. But you are 50% the same as a banana. Which kind of makes you wonder, if you put bananas on your cereal in the morning, is it cannibalism? I mean, you know, hello? And the last time I looked, a banana is a plant, is that correct? Well, you're 50% the same as a banana, and if we have any gardeners here, I also want you to know that you are 35% the same as a daffodil or narcissus. It's the same plant. But so you're 50% the same as a banana and 35% the same as a daffodil or narcissus. But at least that is biblical, right? I mean, we're supposed to bloom where we're planted, correct? Hello? Well, I'm not finished. Again, using this absolutely absurd method of comparison, I want you to know that you're also 88% the same as a rat. I would remind you, you're only 70% the same as a chimpanzee, but you're 88% the same as a rat. But I am not finished. Again, using this absurd method of comparison, I want you to know that you are 60% the same as a chicken. Now, you know what a belt is around a minister? That's a fence around a chicken graveyard. Now, let's think. The last time I looked, a chicken is a bird. Is that right? Right? So, let's see. You are 50% the same as a plant, 88% the same as a rat, 60% the same as a chicken, which does make you wonder when you eat the gospel bird if it's, again, cannibalism, correct? But again, using this absurd method of comparison, I want you to know that you are 70% the same as a sea sponge. Which does beg the question, I think you'll have to agree. If we are 70% the same as a sea sponge, maybe, just maybe, we really are related. Well, again, I'm not finished. Using this absurd method of comparison, I want you to know that you are 88% the same as a sea squirt. Apparently you don't know what a sea squirt is? No? Well, let me show you the picture of a sea squirt. This is the picture of a sea squirt. And you are 88% the same genetically as a sea squirt. Now, particularly for the young ones that would still be in school, I hope that you'll at least listen to this. What is a sea squirt? The kids love it when I do this. What is a sea squirt? Technically, it's an animal. And when it's a young sea squirt, it swims through seawater and it has a brain. However, when it becomes an adult, it attaches to the sea floor, converts into a filter feeder like sponges and corals, and the brain dissolves away. As an adult, it doesn't have a brain. Hello? Now, here's my question before Pastor comes up to close us out. You are 88% the same as a rat, 88% the same as a sea squirt, but you're only 70% the same as an ape. Is that correct? So please tell me tonight, which one are you closer to? And I'll let you make your own decision. Pastor?
Well, again, we've seen evidence tonight that the creation, and it just points us to the truth of what God's already told us. Amen. And the Bible says in John chapter 1, now I'm glad when Jesus came to this earth, he didn't have to wait millions of years to evolve into a human being. And the Bible says in John chapter 1, verse number 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory. The glory is the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Hebrews chapter number 7, verse 24. But this man Christ, because he continueth forever, hath an unchangeable priesthood, wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost that come to God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. For such a high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. And aren't you glad that our Savior loves you enough? He didn't come to save the monkeys. He didn't come to save the apes. He came to become flesh, to become a babe in a manger, conceived of the Holy Spirit of God, virgin born, the incarnate Son of God, the God-man, the Lord Jesus Christ. There's one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. And aren't you glad tonight to know that your Creator God loves you enough that he became you and he became us? But the difference was he was without sin, amen? And that's why he could be our sacrifice. So tonight, Brother Thomas, you come as we sing invitation. If you have a need tonight, you come. If you're not saved, dear friend, you need to be saved. Jesus loves you. Your Creator God loves you. And he sent his Son Jesus, who came in the flesh, who died as you, died a death that you couldn't die, live a life that you couldn't live. And he defeated hell, sin, and the grave so that you and I could be saved. And so all these things are wonderful facts. But the greatest truth that we're trying to point men towards is that Jesus died for the sins of the world. And dear friend, God created you for a purpose and a reason. And God's will for your life, number one, is that you be saved. So whatever your need is tonight, if you have a need, you need to come and pray. If you need to be saved, this is your moment. This is your time. Brother Thomas, we sing a couple verses of invitation.
Stand, please. 166. Search me, O God, and know my heart today. Try me, O Savior, know my thoughts, I pray.
Somebody to come with you. Amen. Father, we thank you.